1999. And may I have a roll call, please?
Chairman Carson?
Here.
Council Barry?
Here.
Council Fritz?
Here.
Council Watson?
Here.
Council McGinty?
Here.
Council Roberts?
Here.
Council Swift Kayata?
Here.
Thank you. Pledge of Allegiance? I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Are there any reports and correspondence? Councilor Barry?
The summertime seems to be a difficult time to get together the Committee for Historical Preservation. We were unable to summon a quorum the other night on August 5th, and so we're going to have to postpone that meeting for another time. And, we're also very interested in receiving feedback from the community. We'd like to know if people are interested in a historic preservation ordinance. We've been working hard to draft proposals for an ordinance, and we'd like to have as much input from the community as possible. So they can either contact the town hall and express their wishes or get in touch with one of us. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Any other reports, correspondent?
Just wanted to mention that the Town Council Ordinance Committee is going to be having a meeting on Monday, the 16th at 4 o'clock, 16th of August. And if there's anyone interested, we'll be dealing with the Town Farm Ordinance. And then I just want to mention also that on this Thursday, the 12th, from 6 to 7, the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust will be having a dedication of the Hobstone Trail that will be open, that is open to the public now. And that's been partly paid for by the town, so I think it's a very nice opportunity to dedicate that trail.
Hey, thanks. Any other reports and correspondence? Yes, Councilor McGinty.
I'd like to offer my congratulations to the organizers and volunteers for the Beach to Beacon race. The second annual race was held last Saturday. It was another great success, it was great to see so many people out along the course cheering on the runners, and certainly I'm sure it was fun for all, and again, congratulations to that. I understand it went very well. I see the police chiefs here and the fire chief, I know, were behind organizing the town employees and involvement in that, and it's just my congratulations to the entire effort again this year.
I'm sure that's echoed by not only the council, but most citizens in this community see that it ran so smoothly. We also have another award winner in our midst. The clerk, the town clerk of Cape Elizabeth, is a big award winner, and I can't remember what it's called.
Lorraine Fleury Award.
And could you just explain that to the public for a moment, please?
Yes. You know, we all know here in Cape Elizabeth that Deborah Lane does an exceptional job running the municipal elections and the presidential elections and whatever other elections they wish to throw her way from Augusta. Fortunately, very appropriately, at a election seminar this past week, the election conference is held annually by the Secretary of State. Dan Gwardowski, who is the Secretary of State, announced the one annual honoree to receive the Lorraine Fleury Award for exceptional service to the election process in the state of Maine. And, Deborah Lane was the very deserving recipient of that award. I know everyone in the community joins the council, myself, all of Debbie's co-workers in congratulating her.
Right. Next. Next week, there'll be a ticker tape parade on Fifth Avenue for Debbie. Yeah, we'll send you down there.
There is one other matter, Madam Chairman. I went in your place because you had a conflict to the meeting in Portland where that building inspector got an award, and this organization makes it possible for the town of Cape Elizabeth to enjoy a 10% to 15% break in insurance rates because of the overall. I'm sure that Mr. McGovern can explain more about the association, but Bruce Smith took part in that, and we're pleased that he brought home the certificate, which hangs on his wall. And I think he should be commended for doing that for the town.
You're right. Thank you very much. I also wanted to say something about the Centennial, I sat on the Centennial Committee and on the Fundraising Committee, and it was one of, I've been on a lot of committees in this town over my nearly 60 years living here, and this was an opportunity to see citizens that some of whom I did not know and had not met, some citizens who'd only lived here a year or two, who just threw themselves into this celebration to perform unbelievably a lot of time and energy that went into it. I think it ran very smoothly. I think it was unfortunate that it rained. However, the drill team did perform, and that was good. Is this something you want me to?
No, no.
So I think that many citizens are to be congratulated. It was an event that we've not done before, although we have started with Family Fun Days, which I was also a co-chair in the very beginning, but this was really a big event, and a lot of people came, and a lot of people had a good time. We also ought to thank that our own citizens, that our other citizen, Mr. Murray, who did a fantastic job of setting up the fireworks, and I thought they were quite ethereal and quite nice looking behind the clouds and the smoke that they were there. But I went down there and observed. He gave me a full explanation of everything, and it was really a terrific job. And where those fireworks are paid for, he does offer the service to what he does for free. So there was a terrific opportunity for everybody to participate, and I thought it was a great success. Citizens' discussions of item not on the agenda. Hearing none, we will move right to the minutes of the meeting held. Well, we have 2 minutes, right?
Three.
And actually, that date should be July 12th, not July 9th, I believe.
It is July 12th, yeah.
July 12th.
If you've had an opportunity to look at those minutes, are there any changes, omissions, or additions to be made? Any of those?
Madam Chairwoman, on item 2199-2000, on the vote for the Riverside Memorial Cemetery, the vote should have been 5-2 on that. It was noted at 7-0.
I certainly want that changed. I want everybody to know that I voted to accept those roads as presented to me by that committee. So could that vote be changed to 5-2, please? Any other errors or omissions? If not, I'd like a motion to accept the minutes.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. The minutes of
July 12th.
July 12th, June 29th. What's that?
June 14th, 9900, 1999, 2000.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Be accepted. All those in favor? Thank you. Item number 24. Maybe I will let the clerk again speak about the name changes for roads in the new road sections of cemetery, of Riverside Cemetery.
Thank you. Per request of the council last month, the Riverside trustees did revisit their proposed road names for the expanded section of Riverside. They are recommending the area around the flagpole as Lilac Lane, the outer road Sycamore Lane, and the inner road Dogwood Lane. I've also spoke to Chief Pickering, and he felt that at this time this would not interfere with the proposed E911 roads.
Thank you. Is there any discussion? We have a motion.
I move that the names be adopted as they are printed here, Lilac Lane, Sycamore Lane, and Dogwood Lane.
We accept the report of the Riverside Committee.
Yes.
Second.
Any more discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? None. It carries. Thank you. Item number 25, receipt of the report from the Enhanced 911 Addressing System. As you can see in your packet, there is a large number of potential, this is a work in progress, potential name changes for roads, and it is, I think, our responsibility to accept the report and not to act on it at this time, although at the final end of the report we will be acting on the name changes. I also would like to ask the manager to ask the, we have to have some way of getting this information out to people whose roads may have some name change. I'd like to ask the staff to do that, to do that by mail. Do you have a plan, Chief Pickering, for that?
The assessor.
And the assessor, could you just tell us what that plan is to go from here, what you do? Somebody?
We actually have two groups of residents which may experience some changes if this is approved. One is a name change, the other is a number change. We have all of those in computer. Bob's done a great job for us through the Office of GIS to locate these individual streets and individual residents, and we will be able to notify them by mail of this impending hearing, if you want to have that.
Will it be a notification, or will, when a person wants to appeal the name change, what, do we have a process in place?
There is a process in place. You know, if you look at the Office of Emergency Services Communications Bureau, there was some urgency suggested by them the last couple of months that this project was moving ahead. And it did get fast-tracked the last couple of months. I did meet with representatives from Bell Atlantic Friday. They tell me that this implementation probably won't be complete until next July. Mm. So we still have a year, but there is some urgency in trying to get these road name changes effected as soon as possible. So what we tried to do was come up with names which would give us a jumping off point. If individuals in certain neighborhoods, certain streets have an issue or a problem with that, we're willing to let them try to come up with some compromise that will make them happy rather than us interfering in that process where it's a street name that they'll have to live with. So that is an informal process. Ultimately,
what kind of process?
An informal process. Ultimately, I guess as the addressing coordinator, I could make the final decision, but they'd certainly have input through this public hearing process.
So when we send a letter out, or whoever sends a letter out to each of the citizens, or to however you break this list down, in that letter we'll explain to them what you're doing, what the name change is, and what their, how they can speak to somebody about it?
The proposed name change and their opportunity for input at the meeting, yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Chief, how many of these, this 700 changes proposed here, how many of these people currently probably already know? Any idea?
Well, I really have no specific idea. There's been a lot of conversation, a lot of talk about this. It has been in the Cape Courier. It's gotten a significant amount of publicity. Of those changes you mentioned, however, only 247 addresses are going to have name changes. The remainder are number changes. The street name will not change. So as far as the greatest impact, there's 247 that we've identified at this point that will have a specific name change.
Yeah, David.
Somebody else have a comment?
I just wondered whether both the number changes and the name changes would go out at the same time to the public?
Yes.
That will have the, that will be affected?
Yes, they will.
The plan is you know, the addressing committee, which consists of Chief Pickering, Bob Condell, the assessor, and Phil McGoldrick, the fire chief, will be sending out a letter. They'll be soliciting both written comment by U.S. mail, by email, as well as inviting people to a workshop that they can talk. It's the intent that they hold the workshop as the addressing committee, that it not be the council, so that they can, you know, work through. My sense is from early discussions with the council is you prefer that that level of debate, particularly at that point in time, be done at the staff level. And then the addressing committee will take all of the comments and make a final recommendation to the town council, hopefully with some give and take amongst the citizens involved. And then the council does have the final vote on the actual naming of roads. Many of these 237 are small streets that go off roads that have had the name of the major road that they go by, and under the enhanced 911 process, they're required to name all those roads.
Or have had no name at all.
Or have had no name at all.
What's the time frame for these meetings, the meeting with public?
We were looking for within 30 days or next month to set up a hearing for the public.
Are there going to be two public hearings on this or just one?
I think we'd anticipated one just for public input.
Okay. I have a concern about a couple of these names. One of them is Garrison Field. There's been some concern expressed by some people who live in this community about that name. I think it should be seriously entertained and looked at as to whether or not that name should be maintained, or if we should look at something else. And there's one other name that bothers me a little bit, is Headlight Lane. It would seem to me that we could do a little bit better than Headlight Lane, but maybe there's some rationale behind it that I don't understand on that name. But those are a couple that jump out at me that I think we could take a pretty hard look at.
rationale gets a little sketchy when you're looking at 4,000 addresses.
Yes, I'm sure.
And that's what we started out as. But the Garrison Field Road is one that I think is perfect for public debate, as there are a number of individuals that have strong feelings about that. Both the council and the planning board suggested that we used historical names as a method of naming these streets, and we found that to be almost impossible. In fact, that would be a historical name, which some people are taking issue with. So those kinds of addresses, we'd really rather have the residents make that debate and come up with a consensus rather than have us suggest another name. Headlight Lane, you know, that certainly could be changed, but we did the best we could with what
sure, I understand.
The amount of addresses we had to work with.
I think it would be best, as you've proposed, to try and get the residents of the people who live on that street to agree if there's some conflict, to let them settle it amongst themselves if possible. There may be some need to get you on the committee involved, but I don't feel a need for the council to be involved in telling people what their street names should be.
I agree 100%, and certainly tonight is not the appropriate time to do it. And I also would like to caution the council that when this begins to move through the community, that I think it's inappropriate for an individual councilor to be taking the complaint or the concern of one citizen about the road change and trying to act on it themselves within the council when we have an adequate and superior committee who's thinking this whole thing through and working at this. And if that citizen calls, they need to go where everybody else needs to go, which is to that committee. And that we have, some of us have received letters about some road changes, and certainly that needs to go to your committee and not to us at this time. So we caution all of us to do that. Julianne.
As well, if council members have any suggestions, please feel free to email them to the chief, your citizens as well. Feel free to communicate.
We have no personal stake in these roads. Toward the end of it, we were kind of going, what doesn't rhyme with anything, so.
Councilor Fritz.
Just all the changes that you're recommending, do you feel that those are all safety issues? I mean, that there really is a safety need to change these names because of confusion.
To give you an example, if we'd followed the state protocol strictly as it is written, we would have changed over 1,700 address names. So we've gone from there to 247. So we've really tried to compromise and tried to address the council and the planning board's issue of mitigating the impact of this on town residents as much as possible. The first thing, in fact, we would have had to have done if we were going to subscribe strictly to the state standard is change Ocean House Road, because we've got three Ocean House Roads and other ocean roads, and the idea was to not have any road that sounded similar. But we felt that when E911 comes into effect, these names are going to come up on a computer screen. And even though they may sound alike, as long as visually they look different, we felt that the dispatchers could make that distinction and put out those addresses appropriately. So we winnowed down this list considerably from the 1,700 we started with originally.
Well, I'd just like to take this opportunity to commend you and the committee. I'm sure this has had its controversial moments and will indeed probably in the near future, but I know you've worked hard on it. I think we all thank you.
So any more discussion? Thank you, Chief. We need to vote
like
to accept.
Move receipt of the report.
Mm-hmm.
From the enhanced 911 addressing committee.
Second.
Thank you.
Second.
It's been seconded. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All not. If not, all those in favor? Any opposed? Carries. We have in our packet a proposal from the community services for the material to put in their fall brochure for the fees for the new pool. It will be ready. And I'm going to ask the manager to speak on that before we speak to the councilors.
It was interesting. Prior to this meeting, the town council went down to the Donald Richards Community Pool and had a tour of the facility. And one of the building committee members, we had the pool building committee, and said, Mike, you got to really start marketing this pool. And community services needs to. And, you know, I think, interestingly enough, the very first, you know, step in beginning to market it is to set the fees. And the citizen who brought that up was pleased to hear that the council was, in fact, beginning that this evening. Back in May, the town council adopted a budget for the swimming pool that contained these fees at almost approximately this level. There's slight changes, but it's still essentially the same as you had in your budget proposal back in May. With the fees, as in the budget, 100% of the debt service cost of the pool, the principal and the interest, is going to be paid for out of the property tax. For the operation of the pool, as well as the related fitness room, $83,000 of that, roughly $81,000, is still subsidized by taxpayers. So even though some may have concern with some of these fees, I think it's important to note that 100% of the cost of the construction of the pool and approximately 40% of the operating cost of the pool still paid for by taxpayers. The hope is twofold. One, that the users will show a willingness to pay the fees, and two, that in the longer run we'll have higher use than Sue Weatherby has initially predicted, because the hope is that we can increase particularly the percentage of operating cost. However, we do not know of any community pool anywhere in the state of Maine where 100% of the operating cost is in fact paid for by the users. The pool committee did quite a bit of research on that. What's really interesting, I think, about this fee structure is that there are different levels of membership, from individual adult to student to family, and for the first time, senior citizens will be paying small amounts relative to some of the other amounts for use of the pool. There's also combination memberships. The highest amount on the sheet that the council is looking at is for a combination pool and fitness center family annual fee of $375. However, you know, people could go individually, do for a single use of the pool for $3. Individual adult annual fee is $200. So there are all sorts of options. Individual adult monthly fee is $25, senior citizen $20. So, you know, the pool and the related fitness center is going to be a tremendous resource. And Sue Weatherby, the Director of Community Services, has brought forward these fees based on the budget, and she does hope to include them in the brochure that's about to go out for community services. Also, any resident, under this proposal, any resident membership purchased prior to the start of the new year will receive a 10% discount as a way of initially trying to get folks to see that the pool is there and to begin to use it. Sue is cautiously optimistic that the revenue projections are going to be met, and I know if, you know, with her leadership and Janet Brown's, you know, if it's anything like what Sue does and anything else that she works on, it'll be a major success.
It is our responsibility tonight to adopt these if that is the wish of the council. So now it comes.
Yeah, Madam Chairman, two questions. I'd like to get a copy of what the prior schedule was. There was nothing in the packet on that, and I'm not familiar with what they were charging previously. And I'd also like to have something that would show us a comparison of what, say, South Portland or other community pools are charging. Not that I'm opposed to the schedule, but just that if people have questions, I can give them an intelligent answer as to how we compare with others or how much we've gone up or whatever.
That was all provided back before you were on the council, so we'll get all the council members copies of that again.
Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Councilor Sufiera.
Thank you. I do have one question on this page, pool resident memberships. For every other category, there was a category of individual student, but there was not an individual student pool resident memberships. And I didn't know if that was, if there was some reason that it was left out, or if it was just inadvertently, it's a typo.
I don't know, but my sense is you probably stumbled upon something that needs to be corrected.
Okay, I would have called Sue Weatherby this morning, but she's away.
She's on vacation.
I just wanted to bring that to our attention.
What we'll do is, I'll talk to her, and if we do need to do that,
I have no
bring
concern
it forward
about
the
fees, but I just wanted to point out that.
It's very good.
Discrepancy.
Councilor Barrett.
You more than stumbled, you studied.
Madam Chairman, I'd like to ask if 18 years means having arrived at the 18th anniversary of birth, or 18 years, are you 18 years old during the whole year that you're 18?
It's generally regarded Councilor Berry, Attorney Berry, as the anniversary
Don't pick on me for that.
Of the 18th year of birth. So when one celebrates their 18th birthday, they've completed 18 years of life on this earth.
Okay, fine. But the 18th birthday is the breaking point for student membership.
That's right.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions or concerns?
Just one other question. Will there be membership cards or something like that? How will people at the pool know?
Yeah.
I presume they'll take
I think they have that pretty well figured out. They're working on the parking issues and the membership issues. Is there any more questions? I'll entertain a motion.
I move that we accept the proposed fee schedule for the Don Richards Community Pool and Fitness Center.
I second it.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any other further discussion? If not, we'll accept the report as proposed, and we'll check into that one change. All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. The motion carries. Item number 27, a receipt of the report from the Cape Community Coalition. We have Officer Gasper here who will speak on that.
Good evening, Madam Chairman. The good news is that this presentation will be brief, like my last one to the town council. The more good news is that I'm not up here alone. I have with me tonight a couple of folks who I consider to be fantastic co-workers in the community and just plain good friends since my employment here. One is John Cranshaw, and the gentleman seated behind him is Terry Johnson. They are both very active members of the Cape Coalition. The reason I'm here tonight is to clue the town council on an opportunity that we've received. It's no secret to my co-workers and to my administrators that I have been and always will be an advocate for community policing, especially in the venue for citizens really working with the police department and providing a safe environment for themselves and taking some responsibility for that community. Given that vein of thought, I'd like to also take this opportunity to thank the members of the Cape Coalition who I've had the extreme pleasure to work with over the past 2.5 years in my tenure as community officer. It's without their encouragement and help that this would not have been half the rewarding experience as it has been. The object that I bring to you tonight is that we have before us a fantastic opportunity, an opportunity which will really, hopefully by the end of its tenure, envelop the entire community and really create some positive action, not only on concentrating on youth issues, but really concentrating on community issues in general, taking into account adults, municipal government, and just general folks at large. The news that I have to bring with you is that the coalition in working, in partnering with the police department and with the support, the wealth of support from my administration in bringing this program to Cape Elizabeth, the coalition and the police department have applied and have been granted a position as a test site for the VISTA program. This VISTA program, if you don't know, VISTA stands for Volunteers in Service to America, and it is a division of AmeriCorps, which is also oversees the Peace Corps program. VISTA was the envisionment of John F. Kennedy in 1963 before his tragic assassination. It was implemented in 1964 originally to deal with poverty issues in urban areas. Now in the state of Maine, we have a movement both on the part of the governor's cabinet on children as well as Maine Communities for Children to address issues in the state as far as building positive assets and providing a community base by which we all benefit from helping each other, whether you're a youth, senior citizen, municipal government, or just a citizen. And through that, we have had the opportunity to hire a VISTA volunteer. I say hire in the fact that this person will be responsible for bringing some real positive change to this community and the fact that they will be quote-unquote employed here for 12 months, for a year. And in that year, it is their job to work as a member of the coalition. Now, I say hired in the fact that these folks are paid by the Corporation for National Service, which oversees the AmeriCorps program. They will not be paid by the coalition. They are not being paid by the police department. This is coming strictly from the federal government. And there is little, if no cost, to this community whatsoever. what we hope to achieve with this Vista volunteer in their capacity with the coalition is really to provide some asset building base, some resource mobilization, which is to include all aspects of this community, adults, youth, municipal government, police departments, what have you, as well as providing project sustainability, i.e. the CAPE Coalition. There's still many people in this community that, don't realize the real positive effect that the coalition has throughout this community, and hopefully at the end of this tenure, they will be able to realize that importance. The only other thing I'd like to say is that, again, this is a fantastic opportunity. It's a little or no investment on our part. My part in this as a representative and partner with the coalition, as well as a representative of the police department, is to be a site supervisor for this Vista volunteer, to make sure their needs are being met, and to work side by side with them in realizing the goals that we've set for them as a CAPE coalition. What I'd like to do is turn it over to John, who will talk a little bit more about what the coalition hopes to gain from the Vista volunteer. And I would invite any of you that have questions of me to feel free to call me at any time at the police station or at 1226. John.
I'm going to use Paul's outline that he handed out to all the coalition members because he did a really good job on it. The first thing that he hit upon with what the Vista volunteer will really help as far as the coalition is that part of the coalition's problems through the years has been really, as he said, getting out to people. There are a lot of people who don't know what the coalition is about, don't know what we're doing and everything. And one of the main purposes that we hope that this Vista volunteer would take on would be the idea of them going out to different groups, be it the Lions Club or Rotary or something, and getting different groups and people to know about the coalition that otherwise ordinarily wouldn't know about it. We've been trying, you know, we have a few official positions that, you know, are supposed to, you know, go out when a group is looking to find out what the coalition is, but conflicts are always coming up and, you know, time is hard to find. So that it is often difficult to find the time to therefore make the presentation to people. By having a Vista volunteer there, it would obviously make it very simple to have a representative, you know, as almost a figurehead of the coalition to be able to say, all right, well, this person, you know, will write it into their schedule, you know, they're, you know, looking for things to do each day, you know, to therefore, you know, represent the coalition, you know, and it would be in their job description to therefore get it out to these groups. Another key thing that would come from the getting out to different people and educating people about the coalition and its purpose is therefore to also bring in more members for the coalition. We've kind of increased a little bit, but you know, we lose people and so forth, so that our core group has basically stayed the same at probably about 10 to 15 people through the years. And so with this constant reaching out to the community and so forth, we will hopefully be able to increase the number of active members that are really going to take a significant role in getting out to the community and therefore making a larger difference. I think those are the main points that it really will, it will have a figurehead so that there's someone that at all times will be able to be reached for the coalition, which is important because, you know, we have the coalition, but there are so many different members and, you know, if you're trying to get in touch with the coalition, you can never really be sure, you know, should I be in touch with this person or that person and so forth. So this would really be a good thing as also organizational. Did I miss anything you want to add?
Yeah, I might add one more thing. The only last thing I'd like to add is that I know folks say, as in grants, you know, what happens at the end of that grant period, or you know, whether it be 3 years or this 12 months. The whole goal and objective of this 12-month program is to provide that project sustainability. That's just a big word for saying that. Making sure that the groundwork is set, that the coalition is self-sustaining even after that Vista worker, whoever that may be, leaves to go on to bigger and better things. And that's what we hope to achieve, and that's what we look forward to over the next 12 months We look to bring somebody on probably by the end of August, beginning of September. We have not chosen anybody at this time, but we do have candidates that we are looking at.
Thank you very much. You speak very well publicly. I wanted to speak to the young man. I've heard Officer Casper speak before. Does any of the councils have any questions while they're up at the podium? Councilor McGinty.
Little or no cost, you said a couple of times. What are we literally looking at as far as budget or anything like that?
Any cost would not be incurred to either the police department or the municipal budget. Any cost not covered by the AmeriCorps VISTA program would be covered from monies owned by the coalition. Therefore, that would be like a phone line cost or the cost of buying a typewriter or any type of equipment. None of that cost is borne on the town whatsoever.
Thanks.
Any other questions of them? Yes.
Yeah, Paul, this evening on PBS, on the radio coming home from work, he indicated that in Congress there's a move afoot to try to cut away the funding for AmeriCorps. Would that affect this year, or is funding already in place for this year to do what you want to do?
It's my understanding that funding is already in place, and this has been secured through Maine Communities for Children, which is a statewide initiative. We will be a local test site for that, all of that information going back to the state level and the governor's cabinet. So it's the short answer is yes, I believe those monies have been secured for this person.
Yes,
Paul, is this going to be the candidates you're looking at? Are they from our community or from the greater Portland community?
The selection process is open nationwide. Therefore, we could have a candidate that's from Oregon, Virginia. To be quite honest, we would look for somebody that may be outside of this community, somebody that may have a fresh perspective and may not have ties that may conflict or cloud judgment or may prohibit them from acting autonomously within the organization of the coalition.
Okay. Any more questions directed to them out of the podium?
I just think Barry? Perhaps for the folks at home, it might be helpful for them to understand the coalition itself is between what groups?
Mission statement. I have this mission statement in front of me. I've often had to explain to people what the coalition is, and I can never remember exactly what the mission statement is, so I'm pretty happy that Paul gave me this piece of paper this morning. The Cape Community Coalition is a community-based group comprised of local residents, students, seniors, and local government to further community collaboration. This collaboration is a key component of the Cape Coalition's goal of promoting health, well-being, and mutual respect between generational and geographical sections of Cape Elizabeth. Hopefully that wasn't much, hopefully that made some sense. I don't know, it's kind of wordy and so forth and trying to be politically correct and everything, but I think it gets the point across to a degree.
Bridging the gap between the generations and the geographical sections of Cape Elizabeth?
Yeah, I guess it would be for geographical sections. Is that what you're asking? I'm trying to clarify that at all?
I'd just like the folks at home to understand exactly what
the coalition is about. All right, well, bridging gaps between generational sections, obviously, me making relationships and so forth, meeting, senior citizens, younger kids, parents and so forth, really getting relationships with all age groups, not just, hanging out with my peers and, knowing my parents and a few of their friends, really getting to know all the different people in the community and what they have to offer. And likewise, senior citizens, getting to know, me or my friends or the young people younger and so forth, so that it will really help build a stronger community and make it a better place, I guess. For geographical sections, I guess it would look at different neighborhoods and so forth and seeing what different neighborhoods have to offer. If it be certain events that neighborhoods often put on that, another neighborhood might not have or something, there are some neighborhoods that are definitely separated from, other neighborhoods, and bridging those geographical sections is stated here. It's a good thing to make sure that, just because I live in, you know, the rich part of town or whatever, you know, I can still, you know, that I still, you know, learn about, you know, the poor part of town. I wouldn't say there's any poor area, but anyways.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Councilor Frist, did you have something directed to them? Are there any more questions directed to them? Thank you very much for your report. And thank you very much for speaking.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, Council, it is again our job is to receive the report, not to adopt anything.
I move that the report be received.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. The report from Cape Cod Community Coalition be received. Any more discussion?
What is the process here? If we're receiving this report, are we approving them to do this? And then what?
Yes.
So we're actually approving this.
Yeah, but we're really not. I think we're going to wait until we're going to receive the report tonight. I think we're going to approve it at a later time. Because we haven't had an opportunity to debate this in any way. I mean, it comes from a subcommittee. It's so hard when they work so hard to do it, you know. And it isn't affecting, from my point of view, it is not affecting our budget. It is something that they're using to work through their process. So at this point, I personally probably would not reject something in hand, but I certainly will accept the report tonight.
I just wanted to understand what the process is here.
All those in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. I see that we've gone out and gotten the plan, so now you can speak on item number 28. Item number 28 is to act upon the proposed acceptance of a pedestrian easement for the town of Cape Elizabeth Greenbelt from a Roman Catholic Bishop of Portland.
I need Mike one McGovern. Of those laser pointers. Have they banned those yet, too? Laser pointers?
I got one in my office.
Back when the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board reviewed the proposal for the site work that's now being done at St. Bartholomew's Roman Catholic Church at the intersection of Two Lights Road and Route 77 and Broadco Road, the Planning Board requested the Diocese of Portland to look into the possibility of providing to the town a pedestrian easement. It wasn't 100% tied down by the planning board. It was simply, would you please consider it? At that point, because of the bureaucracy of the church, and I don't mean that in any negative sense, in the bureaucracy of the town, it just wasn't finalized at that point, and there was a desire to continue to work on it and to get the church approved at that point in time, I think by the planning board and by the church, so that the church community could be back into their own facility by Christmas. What I'd like to do is point this out, and also, obviously, I think everyone knows that I happen to be a member of that parish, and if there's a conflict, it's at least revealed. to give you a bearing, this is the site of St. Bartholomew's Church. This yellow up here is where the church is itself. This purple that you can barely make off in the distance, that is some town-owned land that's at the end of Roundabout Lane in the neighborhood of Broad Cove. As part of our overall greenbelt plan, this is the area known as the Coops as well, and there's also some conservation land that was obtained from the Highlands at Broad Cove subdivision. The problem with all of this trail is there wasn't a connection from Two Lights Road into that area. When Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, looked at this, as well earlier the Conservation Commission and the Planning Board, they saw this as an opportunity working with the church in order to provide that connection to the Greenbelt. However, it is a very wet area, and the way it was negotiated with originally the work that Maureen did, some work that Ost Associates did, and then the town attorney working with the attorney for the Diocese of Portland, is that there would be a boardwalk constructed over the wettest portion, and that once that boardwalk was constructed, the easement would actually narrow up to 15 feet. So it starts off somewhat wider, and then it narrows up to 15 feet at the time the boardwalk's constructed. We don't have a set estimate for constructing that boardwalk. However, it is of a relatively short distance, and it's not something that's at all looked at as a major endeavor. It would be proposed to do it 100% with local funds or donated funds so that we're not in the position of having any federal grant requirements or any of those issues. But it is, I think, a fairly straightforward issue. it happens under the church that the property is actually held in the name of the Roman Catholic Bishop of Portland. That's why it's designed that way. I should make mention, too, that in the actual description you have, the attorneys left off one of the connecting points, if anyone has really studied that. And Maureen O'Meara discovered that. We brought it to the attention of Mr. Leahy. Mr. Leahy has brought it to the attention of the diocesan attorney, and it's been resolved. But it is one of the connecting points listed in that version of the deed you have before you, has subsequently been corrected since last Wednesday.
So the meets and bounds now are...
They conform with the original sketch that the planning board saw back at the time that this was approved.
Can I ask a question, Madam Chairman? Approximately how much is it going to cost to put the bridge, the planking? You know, we're talking about more than $1,000.
It would be more than $1,000, yes.
You got any estimate of about how much?
It'd be off the top of my head, but we're below five figures.
Less than $10,000.
Yes. I don't know the exact amount.
I understand.
Depends on how elaborate it gets.
The type of thing that they did at the Kettle Cove area, where the bridge is over the wet area.
Yeah, one of the service clubs did one over at Great Pond.
Right.
It's worked out quite well. Jack Roberts was a member of the group at the time, still is. Rotary, by the way. There was another one down at Stonegate that Dr. Michael Roy just did, down at Dyer Pond, and give it a chance to go over and look at those boardwalks. Dr. Roy, as a citizen, did all of the work himself and really did a great job in doing it, following up on some work that, again, the Rotary Club working with the Conservation Commission had done earlier. So,
thank you.
I don't know the exact amount, Councilor Berry, but yep. Relatively inexpensive.
Does the council have any more questions to direct to Michael? Yes, Councilor Watson.
If I read this correctly, it's only a temporary easement until such time as the boardwalk is completed, and then it would be granted a permanent easement, is that correct?
Exactly. It becomes permanent and narrows up to 15 feet.
Is there a reason?
Initially, it's 74,000 square feet, and then it actually goes down to a little more than half that once you narrow it up.
Is that the reason why it's only a temporary one? Because when it becomes permanent, it becomes less space, less encroachment upon their property?
Yes. When Maureen had the initial discussions with the local pastor, Father Henschel, it was his desire and whoever he had spoken to that the church property impact be minimized so that they, you know, could still have opportunities to use the balance of land as the church needs developed over the years.
Madam Chairman, I would like to move that the town manager to be authorized to accept the deed and sign on behalf of the town the real estate transfer tax document, which has to be executed at the time the deed is recorded in the Registry of Deeds, and that the manager be authorized to sign the document on behalf of the town, and that the deed in its corrected form be approved by the town attorney prior to its recording.
I'll second
that. Thanks from the Bishop of Portland.
It's been moved and seconded. Now, is there any more discussion? Councilor Fritz, did you?
Well, I'm wondering if after the boardwalk is constructed, can people then walk into the other parcel of land? Does that have a path on it now, or does that need to be constructed? Is that so wet that it needs?
The boardwalk will take care. It'll have a full access from point A to point B at that point, and the boardwalk simply enables you to walk through it when there's water in the ground, which is a good part of the time, even during a summer like this.
And for the benefit of the people at home, what's the pay?
Excuse me, wait a minute, Councilor Berry. Just calling on Councilor Roberts.
Thank you. I was chairman of the Conservation Commission when this land was first donated. And I'm really pleased to see that we've finally gotten this easement. It's something I've wanted for a long time. When I was out campaigning back this past spring, I was down in that neighborhood, and being a hiker as I am, I decided to take a walk through there. And one of my concerns when I was going through that it is growing in. I know part of the council goals are to try to address this and maintain these trails, but we do need to look at it because the dry path in from the end of the road is really filling in quite rapidly. And to just get these pieces of land and let them go is not the way to move forward.
If I might, the discussions I've had with Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, is that we would actually get an estimate together and to put it into the CIP for this coming year to be done next year. Of course, it'll compete with everything else, but the whole issue of a temporary easement is just a lot cleaner. You go in it and you get it done. So, you know, pending other budget priorities and other issues, the plan is to at least have it ready to be proposed to the council during the next budget.
Is there any more discussion on this, Councilor Barrett?
Well, I just had a question. In answer to Councilor Fritz's question, was this an easement from the road to get to the property? Is that right?
This includes a portion from the road, and the actual boardwalk portion is further in.
No, but you can get from the road right across.
Yeah, it fully connects so that you're not trespassing on anyone else.
Thank you. That was my
property.
Is there any more discussion?
Move the question.
Okay, all those in favor? Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Item number 29, action upon proposed town council goals for 1999-2000. Since I was not present at the council goals meeting, I think the council goals are spectacular, by the way, and the presentation and the number of them is terrific. I would ask somebody who wishes to explain to the public the meeting that you had and the discussion that you had and to read the goals. There being none, thank you very much, Councilor Smith.
I'd be happy to do that. Basically, what the council tried to do was to reduce the number of goals so that we would have five. They all fit on one page so that we could have a greater focus on a smaller number of goals. So we worked hard to try to make sure these were prioritized, and I can read through them right now.
Okay.
Cape Elizabeth Town Council goals, July 1st, 1999 through June 30th, the year 2000. First, ensure that quality services are maintained with as minimal impact as possible on the property tax rate. And under that, there are several bullets. Modify the budget process to provide for additional town council time reviewing budget priorities. Early in the budget process, meet with the school board to understand respective expectations. Closely monitor the facilities 2000 projects in order to ensure the best short and long-term value for the citizens of the community. The second goal is to foster greater collegiality with the school board and among boards and commissions and the council. The third goal is to act upon a report recommending a new zoning overlay zone for the town farm, and the reports of the Historic Preservation Ordinance Review Committee and the Community Center Study Committee. The fourth goal is to heighten citizen awareness of the town's open space and green belt with enhanced trail marking, new mapping, and collaboration with neighborhood groups in improving trails. And the fifth and last goal is to work with staff to maintain the town's leadership position in providing a user-friendly website. These were the goals that the council felt were priorities for the coming year.
Thank you very much. Are we ready to adopt those? I'm ready to entertain a motion to do so.
I move that we adopt the proposed Cape Elizabeth Town Council goals for the coming year.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we adopt the goals. Any more discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? It carries. Thank you very much. That concludes the agenda items on this evening's council agenda. However, there was an earlier item that I forgot to call, and I would ask the manager for the town manager's report, which is supposed to come up prior to the time we actually start the agenda items. Town manager.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chairman. I wanted to just report on a couple of things. Unfortunately, during the course of the meeting, a number of them were covered quite well, so I'll skip over those. But the town center project is coming along fairly well at this point. I think I've gotten many, many positive comments about the look of the sidewalk. Some people are concerned about the heights of the trees, but overall, there seems to be very, very upbeat comments on it, the layout, its appearance, and everyone's really looking forward to the grass going in, as well as the lighting. The Scott Dyer Road portion is also coming along fairly well over the next week or so. They're going to begin forming up the sidewalks, and you should actually begin to see those go in. So everything's in shape to be ready by the time the school opens in early September. I presume that's when school opens. So that's going well. Secondly, a major project every year is for the assessor to complete the tax commitment, looking at all the different properties. And you have before you the proposed tax commitment for the year that was on the podium this evening, as well as the sheet which you're passing around, which corrects one minor but important typographical error. I think a couple things are important to note. One is that as a result of the continued support of the legislature for the homestead exemption, all of those who applied for the homestead exemption will be receiving a $7,000 reduction off the valuation. And that's cumulatively saving the taxpayers of Cape Elizabeth $377,300. Very important, and I think it's, you know, the legislature put that in for 1 year. It was questionable whether or not they were going to do it for a second. And I think it's really important, particularly as citizens see legislators, that they comment to them that is important property tax relief. And based on the current tax rate of $19.86 that is proposed, that the assessor has determined will be the tax rate, which is a 14-cent increase, a little under 1%. But if you round that to $20, which we're not doing, but if you did for purposes looking at the homestead exemption, that is saving every taxpayer $140 off their tax bill. And that is a very significant amount and, you know, I think is meaningful property tax relief that the legislature has done. Second, in the packet that you got, also think if you look at the list of top 10 taxpayers, and I think it's really fascinating to see the way that has changed, particularly over the last 5 years. The largest taxpayer in Cape Elizabeth affected this coming year is Chancellor Gardens, which was just constructed this past year, a new facility off Scott Dyer Road. That facility will be paying approximately $110,000 a year in property taxes, with relatively small impact on municipal services. The second largest taxpayer is the Viking, which includes the Viking Nursing Home as well as Crescent House, and the Inn by the Sea is the third largest taxpayer. So despite the lack of much commercial development in Cape Elizabeth, I think it is important to note that out of even the top five taxpayers, when you look at Central Maine Power and Barbuda Club, five of them are in fact non-residential taxpayers. It doesn't add up to a big percentage of the total when you look at it cumulatively. I think the other important point to note as you continue to look at the list, the last three names are homes that were either recently built or totally reconstructed. And you know, and they're all on the shore. We continue to see a trend of what we call teardowns of properties on the coast. We had a building permit just today was issued for a new home on the shore that the stated permit value alone was $2 million on the ocean. So what we're seeing is what's being constructed in Cape Elizabeth right now is extremely expensive. And that has issues for affordable housing. Obviously, we have a lot of older housing stock, but that is affordable, but what is being built new has tended to be very, very expensive. That also looks back, as you look at one of the issues that the council often asks, and with changes in the council, I like to remind the newer councilors that these are questions maybe you should ask. It used to be an issue years and years ago, how much was the overlay going to be? And Penny, I think, now remembers that. Excuse me, Chairman Carson. And the overlay in the tax commitment this year is $166,919. That will be reduced somewhat as the assessor perhaps meets with a few folks and finds errors in assessments, which are natural in the course of 4,000, not that he's not a talented assessor. But there are issues that come up. But it shows that we still, you know, I think we have a very responsibly sized overlay and one that, prepares us well for the next fiscal year as well. So it's a major project to get to this point. It's something we usually don't talk about at a council meeting, but I think it was important to mention a few things about it, particularly the impact of the homestead exemption and the fact that these new expensive homes are beginning to make a real difference in terms of valuation. Thank you.
That's very nice report. Councilor Fritz?
Will individual homeowners have to reapply for that exemption?
No, they do not. No. And if anyone wishes to look at their own exemption to see if they're getting the homestead exemption, Bob Conzo, the assessor, has already posted on the website all of the valuations for every property. So all you need to do is go into the assessing section of the website, www.capelizabeth.com. Go into the assessing section. You can type your last name or anyone's last name. You can type the name of your street, all of the valuations up on your street, and it'll show all of that different information. So it, you know, anyone who wishes to look at this to ensure that, you know, that they are being treated fairly, there is that opportunity to do it, as well as to, for them to ensure that they're getting the exemptions, either veterans or homestead exemption that they believe they should be getting.
Thank you very much. Does anybody, are there any items from citizens that are not presently on the agenda? If you're hearing none, I will entertain a motion to adjourn. It's been moved and
seconded
that we adjourn the meeting for this evening. All those in favor? Thank you very much. All those opposed? Thank you very much.
I think that individual student is supposed to be the same as senior citizens, because it was in all the other.
Turn that off the air.